forfatterpar. Denne uken er de i Skandinavia. Please welcome Siri Hustvedt and Paul Auster. Vi kunne faktisk gjort dette intervjuet på norsk.
Jeg snakker norsk. Jeg snakker bergensk, faktisk. Bergensk dialekt. Men jeg flinkere å snakke engelsk. Det helt sant. Og du vet, Paul kan ikke snakke norsk.
I can't speak Norwegian. Mais je peux parler français comme vous. On peut faire l'émission comme ça, si vous voulez. Hein?
Bien sûr.
But you wouldn't understand a word of what she's saying.
No.
Du kan snakke bare
litt. A few words.
I see. But because your parents were Norwegian.
Min mor norsk, min far snakket norsk, men han var norsk-amerikaner.
But let's do it in English.
We'll do it in English.
We've been talking about love and chemistry.
And, yes.
And I wonder, where are you in this, levels, you know?
We've been together now 32 years, so it's been a while.
You've passed the 18 months.
We got those 18 months out of our system.
Right.
And it's been really pretty good ever since, too, I have to say.
We haven't quite, you know, made it to your moment, Havelock, with 50 years. But I guess we're trying to work on it. Who knows?
Yeah. That would be nice.
But I just want something about chemistry and the brain. There's a lot that is not yet known about the neurochemistry of the brain. And pleasure, and I'm sure, by the way, Ulf Ellevik would agree with me, cannot be simply reduced to neurochemical systems in the brain. We can't do that.
And this neuroscience, this is really a passion for you, a very personal interest.
It's a great passion. For about 15 years now, 12 to 15 years, I've really been studying and have been giving lectures, not just on neuroscience, but on the philosophical implications of neuroscientific models and things like that. So it's interdisciplinary approaches to the science of the brain.
And you actually participate in conferences? And
yes, I do. Yes, it's my other life. Yes.
Incredible. you share a very lonely profession, being authors. Could you describe your daily life? Do you work together or do you work apart? Or how is it?
No, we work apart.
We have a house in Brooklyn, New York. But Siri works in a room on the top floor of the house. But I leave. I have a little apartment a few blocks away. It's a very Spartan place. Typewriter,
and we
pens.
Don't say much to each other at
talk.
Breakfast.
We don't talk in the morning.
Oh, really?
We wake up.
He's friendlier than I am, but I just want my coffee.
And I stagger out and I go to work, and Siri works. And then we meet up 5 o'clock or so, and then we begin our life as a couple, and we do the things that everyone else does. We make dinner and...
And still you don't speak?
Oh, no, we
speak at great length.
We start speaking a lot in the afternoon,
And then I would say that in some way our long relationship, this marriage that has lasted so long now, has been essentially very stimulating conversation. And we talk a lot about a lot of things. And I think that's probably the great pleasure of being such good friends, is being able to share everything.
Yes, and that I actually do not know what you're going to say.
No, and I don't know what you're going to say.
This is very important. You know that you can be surprised.
But as a couple, sharing the same job, after all, and also very much the same life, do you become symbiotic?
Well, there's something that was quoted, I think, that Paul once said to me, because we've been married for such a long time, and I don't know if this mirrors other people's experiences, but something happens so that the associations that we make are often the same. And I think that's very interesting and something to write about, actually, at some point. What is really going on
here? That's why I said if we got to live 100 more years together, we'd wind up being the same person, probably.
That was the joke.
But But still, you're different. How are you different?
I'm man, she woman. Yes.
We have arguments about that too. Yeah. I think
if he is a man or
no, that's clear. We worked that out long ago.
We've got that
pretty well determined. No, I just think that our differences are. I think Paul has had tunnel vision about his work longer than I have. Would you agree with that,
Paul? Well, I'm older than she is, too. By 8 years, there's a difference.
That's true.
And I've been doing it a long time. I realized that, you know, I just had a birthday a few days ago, and it occurred to me I've been writing for 50 years now. Seriously, for 50 years. That's a long time to be doing one thing. And I really have been like that, as Siri says. But you're like that as well.
But do you feel the pressure that you should write more?
No, I don't feel any pressure at all about any of it. It's desire that motivates me.
Yes.
I don't feel the obligation. I've written a lot of books. I've published so many books. Does the world really need another book by me? Well, if it's really good, yeah, then it's worth doing. But it's got to be really, really necessary at this point.
Yeah, but this is the difference because I'm going to be 58. Oh, not next week. I'm going to be 58, and I do feel an urgency about my work. There's so many books that I know I want to write that I want very much to live to write those books.
I finish a book now, and I don't know what's going to happen. I finished one just recently, and I don't know what I'm going to do next. And it usually takes me...
So you could actually quit as well.
I don't know. I hope not. I mean, it'll take a while for the creative juices to start flowing again and for me to plunge back into another work. Right. So in the meantime, I stumble around thinking and dreaming and reading and walking and bit by bit something always has happened until now. So maybe it'll continue. We'll see.
When was it difficult?
You know... The world of art, all the arts, is a very competitive world, and it can be very...